Good morning.
Good morning.
And a warm welcome to our worship this morning. Welcome to you all, and as always, those joining us, wherever you might be in the world, on our Facebook stream. We have a call to worship now on the screen. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord of life. You bring each new day alive with possibility. You fill creation with vitality and hope. You give each human being great potential. You inspire people to transform the world. Lord, come, Lord Jesus, and enter our worship. Come, Lord of life, and infuse our lives. We start to sing our first hymn this morning, O God of Bethel, by whose hand thy people still. Come to God in prayer now. Let us pray. We worship you this day, Lord God, as creator and liberator. For you led the captives out of Egypt, delivering them from the oppression of slavery. You gave laws which enabled people to relate to you and to one another and to the whole of creation. You implored people to worship only you, knowing that whatever was put in your place would all too easily become the object of idolatry. You showered us with blessings by revealing in Jesus just how much you love us. And through him, you delivered us into a new and living relationship with you and with one another, with a new commandment, a commandment of love, to love one another. We praise and adore you, God, this day, Father God, we thank you that you come to us not in the chaos of the whirlwind, nor in the roar of the earthquake, or in the crackling heat of the fire, but in that still small voice of calm, in sheer silence. So we pray that you might quieten our minds today, bring peace to our hearts and stillness to our bodies, that we might meet you in that silence and listen for your still small voice of calm. Give us the courage to go wherever you lead us, trusting that you will prepare the way, gracious and loving God. Lord, we confess that all too often we've let you down. Forgive us for those times when our own wants and desires have filled the horizon to the exclusion of all else, making us blind and deaf to the needs and the concerns of other people. Forgive us for situations when we only see a problem rather than daring to dream of a solution. Forgive us, Father. Help us to transcend self-centeredness and greed. Help us to overcome the ways in which we failed you. Restore us to your love, we pray, as we bring these our prayers to you in the name of Christ our Saviour, who taught us when we pray together to say the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Well, the only intimation to mention this morning is to update you on the gift aid, the recent gift aid that we had, and the latest total that we have at the moment is £7,280, which is a fantastic amount of money and a tremendous result. And so, as always, a huge thank you to everybody who has contributed to this. It really is amazing. And a huge, yes, thank you. And I should say that we hope the total will increase, obviously because of gift aid, there will be an increase in that total, and you're still welcome to give to gift aid over these next few days if you haven't done so already. So again, thank you very much to everybody. Well, we turn now to God's Word, and our reader this morning is in the lady.
Samuel 2, chapter 5, verses 1 to 10. David becomes king over Israel. All the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and said, "We are your own flesh and blood. In the past, while Saul was king over us, you were the one who led Israel on their military campaigns. And the Lord said to you, 'You shall shepherd my people Israel, and you shall become their leader.'" When all the elders of Israel had come to King David at Hebron, the king made a compact with them at Hebron before the Lord, and they anointed David king over Israel. David was 30 years old when he became king, and he reigned for 40 years. In Hebron, he reigned over Judah for 7 years and 6 months, and in Jerusalem, he reigned over all Israel and Judah for 33 years. David conquers Jerusalem. The king and his men march to Jerusalem to attack the Jebusites who live there. The Jebusites said to David, "You will not get in here. Even the blind and lame can ward you off." They thought, "David cannot get in here." Nevertheless, David captured the fortress of Zion, the city of David. On that day, David said, "Anyone who conquers the Jebusites will have to use the water shaft to reach those lame and blind who are David's enemies. That is why they say, 'The blind and lame will not enter the place.'" David then took up residence in the fortress and called it the City of David. He built up the area around it from the supporting terraces inward. And he became more and more powerful because the Lord God Almighty was with him. The next reading is from Mark chapter 6, verses 1 to 13. A prophet without honour. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. "Where did this man get these things?" they asked. "What's this wisdom that has been given him, that he even does miracles? Isn't he this carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "Only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house is a prophet without honor. He could not do any miracles there, except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them, and he was amazed at their lack of faith." Jesus sends out the 12. When Jesus went round teaching from village to village, calling the 12 to him, he sent them out two by two and gave them authority over evil spirits. These were his instructions. "Take nothing for the journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in your belts. Wear sandals and not an extra tunic. Whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that town. And if any place will not welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off your feet when you leave as a testimony against them." They went out and preached that people should repent. They drove out many demons and anointed many sick people with oil and healed them. Amen, and thanks be to God for these readings from his holy word.
Ask the average person what they think of the state of humanity today, and the chances are that you'll probably get quite a negative response. But the world is a terrible place, and humanity is making a mess of things is a fairly universal view. But the behaviour of human beings is becoming increasingly worse and more immoral is a view held, I think, by many people today. I'm reading a book just now called Humankind, A Hopeful History by Rutger Bregman. And the book seeks to overturn the view that the world is a terrible place and that human beings are a pretty awful bunch. He offers lots of examples and very positive stories to back up the premise that begins at the start of the book, that most people are pretty decent and good. He argues that the fact that we see other people as selfish and untrustworthy and dangerous means that we then behave towards them with defensiveness and suspicion. So it's a vicious cycle. He also says that our view of humanity is highly distorted because nowadays we know everything that's going on. We know all the major events in the world, whereas in the past, of course, people were not so aware. So we watch the news day after day, which of course is generally negative. But he argues that the picture that we get from the news represents a minority of people, and that most people are decent folk. Bregman focuses on the 17th century philosopher Thomas Hobbes. He believed that all that stands between us and violent anarchy was a strong state, strong leadership. Hobbes described civilization as a thin skin of decency, barely concealing the savage ape underneath. So we need the state, we need laws, We need good governance to prevent us all falling into complete anarchy. But Bredman doesn't entirely agree with this view. He instead puts his faith in the 18th century French thinker Jean-Jacques Rousseau, who famously declared that man was born free, and it was civilization, with its coercive powers and social classes and its laws, that was putting man in chains. He backs this up by arguing that for the 300,000 years or so in prehistory, human beings, early man and woman, were living a fulfilling life. They were living in harmony with nature. Everything was wonderful. We were hunter-gatherers. There were no states. There was no government. There were no written laws. And yet, despite that, human beings got on very well and lived a nice, peaceful life. And then he says things went terribly wrong because we discovered agriculture and we began to settle in cities and we were no longer hunter-gatherers. So for the last 10,000 years or so, humanity has been all about property and war and greed and injustice. We began to fight over land and we drew up borders and we created weapons of war and we sought wealth and status in society. So in other words, if it wasn't for the state, if it wasn't for the laws, if it wasn't for all of these things, everything would be absolutely fine. Well, in reading reviews of this book, a lot of people disagree with that. A lot of people think that his analysis of early human history is in fact deeply flawed. The idea that early humans were all going around being lovely to each other, many anthropologists would say, is really quite laughable. But he does, in his book, describe examples where experiments about human nature, he says, were often inaccurate and gave false results. He argues that the idea that humans become savages when the rule of law is taken away is wrong. He says that William Golding's Lord of the Flies is not how the boys stranded on the desert island would have behaved. They would not have turned on one another. Instead, they would have supported and cared for each other. And he tells the true story of a group of young men who really did become stranded on a remote island many years ago and who worked together to support and care for each other. Bregman does not deny that human beings can do evil things, but he says that most of the time we don't. He acknowledges that of course we seek war, but he says we tend in the vast majority of cases to prefer peace. And he shows that even when we do go to war, the majority of soldiers apparently never actually fire their weapons. He accepts that we are often motivated by greed and self-interest. But more often than not, we are motivated by love and caring for one another. So he believes that fundamentally, human beings are good and decent people, that we always have been, but that aspects such as the state and rivalry between states and going to war and money and property have distorted this picture of the good human race. Is he being extraordinarily naive? Is he being simplistic? I'd like to turn now, before I come back to that, to King David. We've been exploring the story of King David over these past two Sundays, and as I said earlier, we're going to be doing this over the summer. And as always with David, in terms of catching up with what he's been up to, a lot has been going on. Remember that last week, David was lamenting the deaths of Saul and Jonathan. And after this, he established himself and his entourage in Hebron. He was then anointed the king of Judah by the people of the local community. King Saul has now been succeeded as king of Israel by Ishbosheth, and he is a very courageous leader, and he has an army commander at his side called Abner. David then has lots of military adventures, as he always does, and at the same time he increases his total number of wives to six, each of whom presented him with a son. Unlike Henry VIII, David was married to all six wives at the same time. Abner, the king, falls out with Ishbosheth and defects to David's side, promising to win over the tribes of Israel. David accepts him on condition that his wife Michal, Saul's daughter, become his wife again. So for a second time, she's passed like a parcel from one husband to another. And then, I hope you're keeping up, when Abner was murdered by David's man Joab in a family revenge killing, David has him buried with great honour so that he wouldn't be seen to be blamed for his death and lose his support in Israel. But then two of Ishbosheth's own men entered his house and killed him while he sleeps, and they present his severed head to King David, thinking that he would be pleased. But they themselves were now killed, and their hands and feet put on public display as a warning to others. Are you following this okay? If you're not entirely keeping up with it all, a quick summary is as follows. Lots of intrigue, lots of violence, lots of death. Which brings us up today with this week's passage, where we learn that King David reigned for 40 years in Judah, and for more than three quarters of that time, the northern kingdom of Israel as well. It's hard not to contrast the qualities which at the time marked David out as suitable for kingship with the qualities of leadership shown by Jesus Christ, who of course is hailed as the son of David, descendant of David, his successor as God's choice of king and Messiah. David is praised for his prowess in battle, his ruthless slaughter of enemy forces, his ever-increasing wealth, his territorial expansion. Contrast that with Jesus, who from the start of his public ministry and throughout it rejects every temptation to establish a kingdom by military force or use political intrigue. Jesus says that his kingdom is radically different from the kingdoms of the world. In his kingdom, the least are the greatest, and those who think themselves mighty will be toppled from their thrones. And far from being a sign of God's favor, wealth is a distraction. It's an obstacle to discipleship. And as we heard in the passage from Mark, his disciples are to go out into the community without weapons or bribing people. They're to set forth with really nothing but their faith in God. No food for the journey, no beggar's pouch, no emergency funds, not even a change of clothes. And of course, we know that Jesus also comes with a strong message, really of bias towards the poor, where he reaches out to the poor, where he heals the sick. Again, contrast that with David, the supposedly gentle shepherd king, marching to Jerusalem, recapturing the stronghold of Zion, renaming it after himself, the city of David. Prior to this particular battle, goaded by the taunts of his enemies, he'd given his men instructions, as we heard, to hunt down the blind and the lame, those whom he hated. He said there was no place for them in his new territory. Yes, that's correct. David orders his men to hunt down the blind and the lame because they had no place in the palace, no place in his kingdom. And the point is stressed that David's power grows because he has God's favour. And the sign of this favour is in the simple fact that David is an absolute survivor. He could have been killed in battle. He could have been killed by a jealous rival. He could have been overthrown by a military coup or ousted by a foreign power. He might have died from the many diseases that were around at that time, where there was no cure. But instead he reigns for 40 years, all taken as a sign of God's great favour. And yet despite that, the more we read about David, the more that we have to acknowledge that he was, while yes, the greatest king of Israel, also a deeply flawed human being. He was a man, of course, of his time. In a society in which people engaged in terrible acts of violence, some of which was sanctioned by God himself. David was a murderer, an adulterer, and ruthless. Contrast his attitude to the blind and the lame and the poor to that of Jesus Christ, and it sums up the huge disparity between these two men. So in returning to what I was talking about earlier, the book by Bregman about humanity, is David more representative of humanity today than Jesus Christ? Are we really a pretty awful species, where despite the occasional acts of love and kindness, we're really all primarily bad? Or are we, broadly speaking, as Bregman argues, good? Well, we are not perfect. Only Jesus is perfect. But are we ultimately good and decent, with acts of evil undertaken only by a minority? But I must admit, there are times when I watch the news and conclude that really we are a pretty bad bunch. There are times when I despair about the state of humanity and the appalling things that people do to one another. And yet, having reflected after reading this book, I don't believe that as a species, as a human race, we are primarily bad and evil. Yes, there are some very bad people in this world, and there always will be. But despite the many flaws, I think, in Bregman's book, I think we are primarily good. For Christians, our calling is to be good. It is to follow in the way of Jesus. And yes, we have often failed in that task. We've often failed to attain the high ideals of Christ's kingdom. We've not lived up to the calling to follow in Christ's way. But we have tried. And in seeking to do so, we have tried to be compassionate. We have tried to love our neighbours. We have tried to turn the other cheek. And we have tried to live in peace with other people. I think that applies to most people, whether they are Christians or not. I think most people are trying to live by Christian moral principles, even if they don't believe in God. Am I being naive? Am I being very simplistic? I suppose this is the kind of sermon where we begin to have a discussion afterwards. Maybe I am being naive, but I simply cannot accept that deep down humanity is bad. And I think to believe that leads us only to utter despair. What hope for humanity if we take such a view? What hope for our future? So I would argue today that to believe in human goodness, to believe that love is always stronger than evil, is to believe that there is always hope for the human race. Amen. We're going to have a video now, and as always, if you wish to sing along, please feel free to do so. And it's one of these songs from the Royal Albert Hall, the Songs of Praise programme, "To God Be the Glory." Thanks today for Jesus and the example that he set of leadership. He was the king who rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. He was the master who washed his servants' feet. He was the one who refused to fight his enemies, but instead said to turn the other cheek. Lord, we praise you and we thank you for Jesus, who sets an example to all of us of how we should live our lives. We give thanks today for those who enter high office for all the best of reasons, and who seek to follow in the way of justice and fairness to all. But we grieve, Lord, for the pressures that so often make the leaders of the nations today compromise, give up. We regret that some fail to follow in the ways of justice and fairness and become corrupt. Father God, we pray for our leaders, for nations, for governments. We pray for peace and unity in our world. And we ask that you might encourage the leaders of the nations to show justice and a concern for human rights in everything that they say and do. Father God, we pray for your church in the world. We know that so often the church lets you down. Lord, we worry about declining numbers, but remind us that weakness for you is strength. We stress about what we should be doing to change things, but remind us that ultimately we need to trust in you. When we look to those who seem to be successful and want to be more like them, turn our eyes upon Jesus and make us more like him. So, Lord, we pray that your church might be Christ's living presence in the world, loving and serving in his name. Father God, we pray for our world. More and more, climate change is affecting us, and we remember today those suffering from extreme heat in North America. We pray for those who mourn the loss of loved ones following the collapsed building disaster in Miami. And we pray for those traumatized and in mourning. We pray for lands where human rights are being trampled upon, places like Hong Kong, where the press are being silenced, the right to protest taken away, and where promises made of the handover to China are being broken. We pray for refugees, often treated harshly by authorities, who place them in camps in poor conditions. Lord, we look at our world and we see so much suffering and pain, so much evil. But Lord, help us to believe ultimately in the goodness of humanity. Help us to believe that love is always stronger. Help us not to despair, but to believe that through your love, there is hope. And now, Lord, in silence, we pray for those whom we know and love, who are ill, who are in mourning, all who need to know of your love. We pray for them in the silence of our hearts. Loving God, hear our prayers, brought to you in Christ's name. Amen. Our final hymn this morning is For the Healing of the Nations.
Thank you.
Spirit be with you and all those whom you love, this day and forevermore.